Today we're talking about Idlib, Syria, a city that, if you don't know where it is on a map, don't worry, it won't be there much longer. Specifically, I want to look at Nikki Haley, our ambassador to the United Nations. Although, after a year of Trump, it's starting to feel like they're united against us. So why are we talking about the United Nations and Nikki Haley today? I mean, when you Google her name, the only thing that comes up are articles about her denying writing that New York Times op-ed. And there you go, that's the entire story right there. How did multiple sources manage to drag that out into more than a page? Anyways, we are talking about Nikki Haley today because of the situation in Syria. Specifically, how a ton of nations with different vested interests are working together in the UN to figure out whether to use an exclamation point or a period in their declaration of potential dire consequences. So, a quick situational breakdown of the Syrian civil war, because the last time anyone talked about it, I think ISIS was still trying to figure out what to do with all this excess land that they had. As you can imagine, things have changed.
There could be a new crisis unfolding in Syria. 30,000 people have been displaced in Idlib province, the last rebel holdout on the verge of falling. CBS's Deborah Pata tonight is along Syria's border with Turkey.
Currently, Syria's territories look like a modern art piece. With so many different nations controlling parts of it, it would almost be easier to just have UN meetings there. Today, we're focusing on Bashar al-Assad's forces, these guys, who have grown massively since last year, and the Syrian rebels who are giving up a fair amount of that land. Well, okay, that's bad for Syrian rebels, but this still very much sounds like a Syria problem. Why are the UN and US talking about it? Well, first, the US would never pass up an opportunity to work with a rebel group. And despite the fact that over the last 5 years, America's relationship with Syrian rebels has been similar to a couple that just keeps breaking up and getting back together, we'll give them weapons. We're ready to commit to one group in the region. 5 years ago.
Major headline tonight involving Syria and word that the US is now ready to arm the rebels.
What? Some of those weapons ended up in Al-Qaeda's hands, but I thought we had something special. 3 years ago.
The program to train and equip Syrian opposition forces has been suspended.
The $500 million program had once been a linchpin of the strategy to defeat ISIS, but so far has proved a fiasco. It was put on hold after a band of fighters turned over their U.S.-supplied equipment to terrorists linked to Al-Qaeda.
Well, geez, maybe we were too hard on them. You know, rebel groups will be rebel groups. We should give them a call and see how they're doing.
As the Syrian dictator continues to use chemical weapons on his own people, the Wall Street Journal, our corporate cousin, reports that U.S. officials are now considering other options that could include giving new weapons to Syrian rebels.
Alright, so we're a bit hot and cold on this one, but one thing we know we don't like is Putin's friend Bashar al-Assad. We don't like this leader because, well, a variety of reasons, but the pertinent one for the episode is, if the UN had a workplace harassment training video on human rights, he'd be the ideal candidate for what not to do. This is worrisome because he kills massive numbers of his own citizens without hesitation. The situation now is that his government has recaptured most of the land from the rebels, and their last major city, Idlib, is clearly going to be attacked and destroyed any day now. The world isn't so much concerned with the attack itself right now, but rather making sure it's being handled ethically. Which sounds odd, but this brings us back to the UN and Nikki Haley. Because so far in this episode, I've mocked the news for not talking about Nikki Haley, and then proceeded to not talk about her at all. Well, here she is speaking at the UN.
Now an offensive against Idlib is starting. Despite the clear warnings of the President of the United States and other world leaders, airstrikes by Russia and the regime have already begun against civilian areas. The United States has been very clear with Russia and with the broader international community. We consider any assault on Idlib to be a dangerous escalation of the conflict in Syria. If Assad, Russia, and Iran continue, the consequences will be dire.
Now it's kind of hard to threaten dire action against a man the president literally ordered his defense secretary to assassinate. I mean, where do you go from there? We'll kill you and then edit your Wikipedia page to make you look like a dick. Well, now that I'm on here, it's gonna be hard to make this look much worse. Anyways, dire consequences. Those two words were heard across the international news recently. Now, Russia and Syrian planes have been bombing the city for over a week now in the politically acceptable way of killing civilians. But worries are, when this turns into an all-out ground war, chemical weapons will be employed, leading to the UN Secretary General saying,
"It is absolutely essential to avoid a full-scale battle in Idlib. This would unleash a humanitarian nightmare, unlike any seen in the blood-soaked Syrian conflict."
Wow, an unprecedented humanitarian crisis in the Syrian civil war. Although I think we can leave this one out of the Guinness Book of World Records. Now, there are a few precedents that we can look at, from Obama drawing a line in the sand regarding Assad's use of chemical weapons and then saying, "Oh, well, the waves washed away that sand line. If only I had used paper or something more permanent." More recently, though, we've seen
American warships launch cruise missiles before dawn local time. The Pentagon hopes the attack made it much harder for Syria's president to use chemical weapons on his own people.
Oh yeah, I remember those attacks from a year ago. That's particularly relevant to today because what spawned those attacks? It was a response to 80 people who were killed, including children, in chemical weapons attacks in Idlib province. Well, that seems relevant to this conversation. Well, that was nowhere near dire consequences. It was the first direct military action against Assad, if you ignore the strategically calculated strike that Obama launched against Assad's wrist. No! This really did change the precedent for what the US was willing to do in retaliation for gas attacks. So, Ambassador Haley, how are we working to stop the worst possible outcome for this Idlib offensive? Well, it just so happens that the US, France, and the UK have begun discussing a plan to attack Syria should chemical weapons be used in an upcoming military offensive. Hey, we're getting the gang back together for another ride. It'll be like Afghanistan the reunion tour. Well, actually that war isn't over, so maybe reunion isn't the right word. This wouldn't be too implausible either, because last April, after a separate chemical attack, we heard,
"I ordered the United States Armed Forces to launch precision strikes on targets associated with the chemical weapons capabilities of Syrian dictator Bashar al-Assad. A combined operation with the armed forces of France and the United Kingdom."
So right now we have two blocs that are arguing against each other in the UN. We have the Russians, Iranians, and Turks being led by the Russian ambassador, and don't worry, we'll get to Turkey. And on the other side, we have the Americans, British, and French being led by Nikki Haley. Although Turkey might have the most vested interest considering that all of this is going on in their border. And if you have intense opinions about your neighbor growing new shrubs too high, or not maintaining their lawn to your standard, just imagine the opinions you'd have if they were considering launching a massive poison gas attack, or engaging in a battle that could lead to millions of refugees just fleeing and trampling all over your front lawn. The Russian ambassador is saying his country cannot allow terrorists to hold hostage and use hundreds of thousands of people as human shields in Idlib. Coexistence with terrorists is impossible, and it is also unacceptable to cover them for being fought against. And to be fair for a second, if you told me that Bush had said that to the UN in order to launch an attack against the country, I wouldn't have believed you. That is way too eloquent, but otherwise, yeah, throw in a few stutters and I think you could have said exactly that. Russia has consistently denied the documented use of gas in the civil war. Maybe it was just a leaky mustard gas pipe going through a few cities. Russia has labeled all of this as a war on terror, to which Nikki Haley responded,
"The Assad regime and its enablers, Russia and Iran, have a playbook for this war. First, they surround a civilian area. Next, they make the preposterous claim that everyone in the area is a terrorist. So every man, woman, and child becomes a target. Then comes the, quote, starve and surrender campaign, where they keep attacking the people until the people have no longer have food, clean water, or shelter."
Wow, that's terrible. Although, at some point, it gets a little weird to use the playbook metaphor. Wiping out an entire city? Classic genocide playbook. There are currently two strategies to avoid a particularly brutal version of this upcoming battle. The first, as we've been alluding to, is threatening invasion if poison gas is used again. On September 11th, it was reported that the United States will coordinate attacks with France and the UK on the Syrian regime if Bashar al-Assad uses chemical weapons again. He referenced the previous bombing that we did as a team and said that this round would be even more intense. At the same time, while we've been talking about this region's imminent attack, I think we should take a moment to talk about this rebel region that seems to have employed the strategy of just sort of slouching down in the back of the class and hoping that nobody notices it. A strategy that seems to be working somewhat well. That is, until September 13th, when US Marines arrived this month in Tampf to join special operation troops already based in the garrison and participate in the drills. That might sound like a losing fight, but come on, has that ever stopped us before? So the other point we can leverage is
Iran, Russia, and Turkey hold three-party talks in Tehran.
Turkey's not a huge fan of making Idlib a humanitarian disaster zone, because apparently people don't like sharing a border with a refugee-laden biohazard. Unfortunately, America can't leverage them too much, because in an unrelated issue, their leader thinks Trump's tariffs have single-handedly wrecked their economy. But that's another story that I talked about a few weeks ago on this channel. Anyways, Turkey, caught between an alliance with the West and its dialogue with Russia and Iran, began shoring up its defenses near Idlib in anticipation of Syria's armed forces launching an attack that threatens to displace millions. So, I guess those discussions didn't go too well? Turkey expressed reservations about a Syrian military operation based on humanitarian grounds. Turkish President Erdogan even penned an op-ed in the Wall Street Journal, and you know how much our president loves op-eds, entitled "The World Must Stop Assad." That was written on September 10th and basically says, "Hey guys, let's not have our final confrontation fight here. I mean, there are a ton of other good cities in Syria for a showdown. Try Damascus, that's a nice city, or Aleppo. Sure, Gary Johnson's never heard of that, but no one's ever heard of him. Let's put him on the map. Just not our border." Anyways, in ongoing discussions, Ambassador Haley is trying to leverage these two things to keep the hits against the rebel city of Idlib above the belt. Until the attack comes, thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello YouTube, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you want to support independent nonpartisan comedy news, remember to subscribe by clicking this floating logo to the right of my head. Or do it the old-fashioned way by clicking the subscribe button below. And remember to ring that bell so that freedom will continue to ring. Remember to give me a thumbs up. Wow, this is a lot of things. And as always, thank you for watching.